بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. There are seven martyrs other than those who are killed in jihad. Narrated Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, five are regarded as the martyrs. They are those who died because plague, abdominal disease, drowning, or wrecking of buildings, and martyrs in Allah's cause. Narrated Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, plague, the cause of martyrdom of every Muslim who dies because of it. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. This is a continuation of reading in the book Sahih al-Bukhari, the most authentic book after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, concerning the chapter of jihad and fighting in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in this chapter, Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi had brought this title, there are seven martyrs other than those who are killed in jihad. So by this, that means there will be eight people. And he brought this hadith, which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had count some of those people who are count or consider or treated as a martyr. And he named five in addition to the one that he already mentioned in the subtitle, which is a person who died in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although that Imam al-Bukhari will brought another hadith which he mentioned about other three, they are not mentioned in this hadith, and inshallah later on when the hadith comes, we will talk about And we want to deal with the word of shaheed or a martyr. Why it's been called shaheed? The scholars give different interpretation and different explanation why he was named as a shaheed. Some of them they said because Allah and his angels witnessed to the ascension of his soul, or that mean he is being given a guarantee that he is safe from hellfire, or that because will be a mark and sign on him on the day of the judgment, which is going to be witnessed that he was a martyr, or that because that the angels of mercy are witness to his death and no other angels will be present in his death, with other explanation been brought by the scholars concerning why been named Shaheed. And also been said that because he is witness and seen and observing the angels when he about to pass away, all that he's witness and watching the Hur al-Ain, as we had stated before, when he died. And in actuality, we have to understand that ash-shuhada are two types. There is a shaheed of the dunya and shaheed of the akhirah. There is a martyr of this dunya and a martyr of the akhirah. And the martyr of the dunya, a person who died in the battlefield in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other types of martyrdom is a person who died by different other types, that is not the fighting and the killing in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is two different rulings applies to both of them. As example, the martyr of this dunya, the shaheed of the dunya, is the one who had died in the battlefield. This person was not supposed to be giving him a bath, washing him or praying on him or anything like this. He's supposed to be buried with the same clothes that he done in it, without washing or bathing or making salah on him. As for the other types of shaheed, are those one they die by other incident and causing and calamity, as we mentioned in the hadith, while the ruling, it doesn't apply to them. You wash them, you make prayer on them to the end of all these things. And they may be sharing the same reward in the hereafter, or that they're going to be resurrected in the same place and the same time. So they have certain ruling which doesn't apply to them in this dunya, and they have other ruling that may apply to both of them. And as we talked before, concerning the 100 degrees that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared in Jannah for those who die in His course, so they may also share in with the shaheed of the dunya some of this degree. And those people whom they've been mentioned already in this hadith, those are the shaheed of the akhirah. And this is what we're going to talk about it now, inshallah, to give some explanation about it. And Allahu A'lam. Will apply to them from washing, burial, and praying on them, etc. And the first of them, that as he mentioned in this hadith, the person who been died by the disease of the plague. And this is a sickness or an illness which it will cause a person to die immediately with no time waiting. And as we understand that one of them had happened during the time of the Sahaba called Umas, and a lot of the companions had passed away in this plague. And some of the Sahaba used to call and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cause them to die by this illness so they can get the reward of being a shaheed. And sometimes that some of them even died, they, him and his, all his family with the plague. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told us that this is a reward for his ummah, and he made even dua and by saying, "Oh Allah, let the death of my ummah be by stabbing or by plague." Because the stabbing is means that you die in the battlefield, and the plague is the stabbing of the jinn. And he said, this is a spot, a white spot, which happened in the person, hand, palm, or under his armpits. And after this, it takes him over by dying very soon. Basically, it is a form of a serious illness and disease, which a person will die immediately. And the second person, a person who called al-Mabtoon, which is the illness also, abdominal disease, which a person will die as a result of it. And this also will be considered and rewarded as a martyr. And any other illness that inside the person, belly, stomach, cause him to die. Also person who's drowning in the sea, also this person will be considered as a martyr. And Sahib al-Hadm, the person who died, a wrecking of a building that falling on him and caused him to die, or somebody pushed on him, and as a result of this, he died. In addition to those five are the person who died in the battlefield. Imam Bukhari, rahmatullahi alayhi, he brought another hadith with other narration, which he added other people that they are not mentioned in this hadith. And this is in hadith Jabir ibn Atiq, which he mentioned about the person who has the illness called Zam, or that the Arab call it Shota. This person will be treated as a shaheed. Also a woman who died during her pregnancy or her childbirth, as a result of her child causing her to die while she having the baby in the stomach or while she delivering the baby, also this woman will be considered as a shaheed. Also the person who died in a fire will be considered as a shaheed. And he mentioned many people, like a person who drowning also under the water, all these things, or a person been stung by a while ill sick and cause him to die, or a person who die falling from the horse, a person who die outside of his homeland, a person who die from the falling from the top of the mountain. And this is the man, Al-Hafiz Ibn Hajar, rahmatullah alayh, he talks cases up to 20 cases that all of them will be considered as a shaheed and a martyr. Although the hadith saying is 7, but it says that the Arab sometimes use the number 7. Not to limit the things to 7, but they mean by this that is a lot. So the number 7 sometimes can be used to give the actual number and sometimes mean that a lot, which is this one of this hadith. It shows you that there is a lot of people that they will be considered as shaheed. Nevertheless, they are not the shaheed of the dunya. They are not the person who will be getting the highest reward and in like Al-Firdaus in Jannah, but they will be sharing some of this blessing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared for the person who died in Allah's cause. And it's out of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy that He made martyr them in the Ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taking different types, different ways. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving this opportunity for this Ummah so they can enjoy the reward and the blessing of being martyr. And Allah is best. Also the Sheikh said that even the types of sickness and illness which it may afflict in the person can be different from person to person, which one is more harmful and more serious, the person will be rewarded more and more, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. MashaAllah, see brother Asir or sister Asir, may Allah reward you for writing. If somebody can write in English, this would be good, and if somebody also can translate, this will be much excellent, make things much easier, I understand. Jazakumullah khairan. And all these things will help, the things will, inshallah, people may copy, or maybe some people will save it on their files. So we appreciate any help and any assistance, inshallah. This is chapter concerning the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not equal are those of the believers who sit at home, except those who are disabled by injury or blind or other excuse, up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever of the forgiving, most merciful. Narrated Al-Bara, may Allah be pleased with him, when the divine revelation came down, not equal those of the believers who sit at their home, was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent for Zayd bin Thabit, who came with a shoulder blade and wrote on it, Ibn Umm Maktum complained about his blindness, and on that the following verse was revealed: not equal are those of the believers who sit at home, except those who are disabled by injury or blind, etc. Narrated Sahl ibn Sa'd, may Allah be pleased with him, I saw Marwan ibn al-Hakam sitting in the mosque, so I came forward and sat by his side. He told us that Zayd ibn Thabit had told him that Allah, His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had dictated to him the divine verse, not equal are those who believe, that are believers who sit at home, and those who strive hard and fight in the cause of Allah. Verse 495. Zayd, may Allah be pleased with him, said, Ibn Umm Maktum into the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while he was dictating to me that verse. On that, Ibn Umm Maktum said, O Messenger of Allah, if I had power, I would surely take part of jihad. He was a blind man. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the revelation to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam while his sight was on mine, and it became so heavy for that I afraid that my sight would be broken. That sight of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was over after Allah revealed, except those who are disabled by injury or blind. This chapter concerning the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are not equal those who sit in their houses and those who are fighting in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this chapter talks about the reward and the blessings that is not equal for those who sit in their house and those who is fighting in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regardless if they have excuse, illegal excuse or not. So after this, when Abdullah ibn Maktoum, may Allah be pleased him, came with exception for this verse. So in the originality of this statement, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making no difference between those who are excused or not excused. And Abdullah ibn Maktoum is this great Sahabi whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had admonished the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu because he had neglected him or turned away from him when he was giving da'wah to the chief of Quraysh. And Allah sent the statement, Abasa wa tawalla. And this Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Maktoum, was a blind man. As a result of this, he could not participate in the battlefield. He could not be there to fight, which it is a side of something very important for participating in the jihad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make this Sahabi feeling good, as well as those who may have a similar excuse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made exception for those who have illegal reason or legal excuse, that they going to be rewarded if they have the right intention, sincere in their heart, and if they don't have this excuse, they will be participating in the battle. So they're going to be equal with those who go and fight in the cause of Allah. And after this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had chosen the reward of those who fight in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and say he have a daraja. And although the term here is singular, but under this daraja, it comes all that reward which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned, as well as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the several ahadith. So under this degree comes all the blessings and all the verses and all the superiority that will be for those who fighting in the cause of Allah. Some people, they may take this verse as an evidence that jihad fi sabilillah is not a must, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says they are not equal. So that means if those who like to go to get the reward is fine, if they want to stay home, there is no punishment for them. But in actuality, we have to understand that this verse is referring to the offensive jihad. The offensive jihad. And also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said Allah prefers those who fight over those who sit in their house. There is no one says that a Muslim can remain in his house forever with no jihad, but they are remaining in their house waiting for their turn to come, as we have explained before concerning the jihad and the obligation of jihad. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had received this revelation, and he called Zayd ibn Thabit, may Allah be pleased with him, and he was one of the writers, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to be a special companion among the Sahaba. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received a verse, he would call in one of them to come with the ink and the tablet to write and record it. And here Zayd ibn Thabit was one of them. So while he was given it, in other hadith which reported by Sa'd, it shows that Abdullah ibn Maktoum had show up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about problem and be handicapped that he's a blind man, he could not do so. And he could not fight. So later on, the revelation came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make exception and to exempt those people who have illegal excuse. And here, Zayd ibn Thabit, may Allah be pleased with him, is saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has his thigh over my thigh. So the revelation started coming to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in this condition, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the revelation, it used to be a very hard moment. And Zayd is telling us, while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his thigh upon his thigh, leaning on it, he felt that his thigh would almost get broken because the heaviest weight that had fallen on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to face difficulty and hardship when he used to receive the revelation. Sometimes he faced turn to red, and sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam be sweating a lot, although is a during the winter. And if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam riding a camel or a horse or a donkey, that the donkey could not be carrying the Prophet anymore during this case, and it has to land down on the earth because the heaviest of this weight. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stated in Quran, if we reveal this Quran on a mountain, you will find the mountain will be break into pieces and splitting because the Quran. You can imagine the Quran be revealed in a human being, i.e. the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, and here also we, this as evidence for those who do not consider the thigh to be a awra or a private part, because Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his thigh was leaning on the side of Zayd ibn Thabit. But inshallah, when this comes, we will talk about it in details, because in this hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had his thigh upon the thigh of Zayd ibn Thabit. May Allah be pleased with him and Allah's best. Wallahu a'lam. Chapter concerning endurance and patience during fighting. Narrated Salim ibn Nadr, may Allah be pleased with him, that from Abdullah ibn Abi Awfa, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you meet them, i.e. your enemy, in the battlefield, then be patient. Chapter, rousing and exhorting people to fight. And the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala urged the believers to fight. Verse 865. Narrated, Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, went towards Khaybar, towards Khandaq, the trench, and saw the Muhajireen, the immigrants, and the Ansar digging in a very cloud morning, as they did not have slaves to do that for them. When he noticed their fatigue and hunger, he said, O Allah, the real life is that of the hereafter. So please forgive the Ansar, the Muhajirin. In its reply, the Muhajirin, they replied to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well as the Ansar by saying, we are those who have given the bay'ah, pledge to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we will carry on jihad as long as we live. Chapter concerning din of the Khandaq, the trench. Narrated Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, that the Muhajirun, the immigrants, and the Ansar started digging the trench around Al-Madinah, carrying earth on their backs and saying, we are those who have given the bay'ah, the pledge to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We will carry on jihad as long as we live. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept on replying, O Allah, there is no God except the God of hereafter. So confer your blessings on the Ansar and the Muhajirin. Narrated Allah, the that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went on carrying the earth and saying, without you, O Allah, we would have got no guidance. Narrated Al-Bara, may Allah be pleased with him, on the day of the battle of Al-Ahzab, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam carrying earth, and the earth was covering the whiteness of his abdomen. And he was saying, without you, O Allah, we would have got no guidance, nor given any charity, nor offering prayers. So please bless us with tranquility and make firm our feet when we meet our enemies. Indeed, those people have rebelled against us, but never shall we yell if they try to bring a fitna, trial and affliction upon us. This chapter concerning patience during fighting the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi brought some of the most important adab and behavior and discipline, that a person who is doing jihad, he has to have it, and this is a sabr and endurance. A person who doesn't have patience, endurance would not be in the battlefield, he could not face the difficulty and the hardship of fighting in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we had stated in hadith before that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about how swords in front of the eyes of a person in the battlefield is trial and itself. So if the person does not have patience to face the enemy and to face his hardship and difficulty and seeing the bullets and the swords, this person could not have it. And this is the reason that Imam al-Bukhari brought this chapter. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned in Quran, oh, you believe, when you meet your enemy, so be firm and be patient and remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After this, he came with the chapter of encouraging and rousing and exhorting the believers to go in the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, i.e., to give them encouragement by telling them about the reward and the blessings and the excellency of jihad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he himself, as his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had made a lot of exhortation and to the people to participate in al-jihad. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did so also, as well as the Sahaba and all the previous generations after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, especially the first century. And we can hope, inshallah, that discussion today about this course, about jihad, participating in it, is one of the means that, inshallah, that we are encouraging people and rousing them towards the jihad. Because this is our obligation that we follow the path of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba. So the same way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it to the Sahaba, and the Sahaba did to himself and each other and those after them, we need to encourage one another towards the jihad. After this, Imam al-Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi had mentioned the hadith of Anas, may Allah be pleased with him, they went for the Khandaq, the ditch which they had to do around the Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had ordered his Sahaba to dig this ditch, and this was became some narration, was the opinion of Salman, may Allah be pleased with him, the Persian Sahabi. And we can imagine how serious it is, this job, especially those muhajirin who don't have mate or servant to help them, they have to dig it themselves. So that the ditch was not around the whole Medina, but was in most of the area, in the places with no mountains to defend the Medina from. And this was supposed to be a big ditch that the horsemen could not cross it. And this would be a mean to protect the Medina from the invasion of those people who had aimed to fight against Allah's messenger and to take revenge from the believers. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he saw the Sahaba and their tiredness and fatigue and their starvation, so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave them the encouragement of these words that we hear in this hadith, which is Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said it by saying, Allah, the real life is that of the hereafter. So please forgive the Ansar and Muhajirin. So this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying this was the means of encouragement for the Sahaba. But also, this doesn't mean that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam negating the verse which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, telling us the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not a sha'ir and is not supposed for him to say poetry. So for a person to utter one sentence or two sentences from poetry, this doesn't make him a person who say poetry. Obviously, it came with this hadith which has same meaning. This hadith ends, may Allah be pleased with him, and also the next hadith, the hadith of Al-Bara. And this shows you that the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them, used to carry the dirt. And how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had participated and carried with him. And he didn't cover with dirt. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his complexion was white, almost like silver. And that how dirt, when he came on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was so noticeable. And to show you, this is also one of the means that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam exhorting the believers towards jihad by participating and by accepting them by this word and by making dua for them and saying, "Oh Allah, indeed the only real life is the life of the hereafter. So Allah bless those muhajirin and those ansar." And also the reply of the ansar and the muhajirin to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This also was encouragement from themselves to one another. Since we're talking about it now, it is the time to discuss the issue of nasheed, or what you call Islamic nasheed, or the war nasheed. We already had talked in details before, but we give a summary quickly about it because this is now related to this issue. So we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did this nasheed as well as the Sahaba. And this shows the permissibility of doing so. It may somebody will say, why come they do not as example recite the Quran or in Zikrullah? And we understand that a person will come with the things which encourage him more and make the job more easier on him. And a person would not be reciting the Quran at all the times. He are a human being and will take a break. And a person will not be 24/7 remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with the need for something to make them more active and to take away them from this fatigue and this starvation who they are in. So some people, they may also have objection and saying, but there's a tone for this anashid that the people say nowadays. We ask the same, who told you what the Prophet said or what the Sahaba said, it didn't have a tone. And what's wrong in the tone itself? And you can see words in itself. In the Arabic term, it shows that it has a tone. And even the Sahaba said it collectively. So for somebody who says that you could not think it with the tone, or you could not say it collectively, we have to come with the dalil and the evidence that it could not be. And with this we come, inshallah, to the ending of our class for day. And inshallah, the Sheikh will be opening the door for questions, answers related to the subject first, inshallah. So for those who have a question related to our subject today, please raise your hand. The question was concerning the companion who had came to the Prophet as an excuse. And this is Allah ibn Ummatun, one of those people who used to call the adhan for the Prophet and his excuse was to be blind. And this is not included in the other verse which talking about this book to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gives him right to go to participate in the jihad, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he doesn't have rights for them.